Okay, got the camera working now. Okay, welcome to the live stream. Let me turn off my phone, which I'm using to monitor the audio. Okay, so welcome to the live stream, where I talk about current projects and stuff that I'm working on. Today we're going to be talking about home automation, networking, and a few other small things, just to fill the time. The stream usually lasts about an hour, though I may cut it at 45 or 30 minutes today, just because I don't have much to talk about. But let me bring down the music a little bit. Okay. So I was going to talk today about the home automation stuff. So I've been getting quite a few questions, actually, about what I meant by home automation when I was talking about it. So, we're going to be talking about Home Assistant mostly, which is actually the program that, or the server that runs in here to actually run all the home automation stuff. So, I guess we'll get started with that. And, make sure all this is working. Okay. So, so home automation. So the, what I use is something, a thing called a Home Assistant, and it is a server that runs on like a Raspberry Pi essentially. And, it will let you do, all your home automation stuff in one area. So here it is. So you can imagine this to be essentially, you know, all the different types of like home automation stuff that's out there, okay? And we're able to use Home Assistant as like an open source platform to kind of communicate in between all those different services. So, you know, let's say we got an Amazon Echo like I do, and you have some LED lights that maybe run through MQTT, like different types of things, and maybe they can't work with each other. But maybe the Home Assistant can act as a hub to allow them to communicate with each other. It also has a very wonderful user interface, and that's a really awesome part about it. So, right here, this is the landing page I got set up. I got just weather here. I got the garage door, the server rack door, and one of the windows in here. Different switches I have set up. You can see like the lights right here. As I flip those, you'll see on my camera the lights will turn off here. And I have my desk lamp right here too, and I'll press that, the desk lamp will turn on. That is really helpful for when I am soldering and I have my hands full with stuff, like really small parts on the workbench that I'm trying to hold together, and maybe I need light or something and I forgot to turn on the light. Super helpful for that. And an exhaust fan. Have that remotely hooked up. A lot of this is for when I'm doing hands-free stuff with soldering, which is actually something you might want to think about. If you're doing something where you have your hands full, you know, projects like that, soldering especially, consider doing this. It's really helpful. So that's kind of what I got set up right now. I'm planning to expand this. I will make a video in the future when I get a lot more home automation stuff. But this is just, I'm just showing you what I got done right now, because this is what I've been working on during COVID and all that stuff. So right here, we have a little temperature module that I put on an ESP8266, which is a little microcontroller that is Wi-Fi connected, and it can, you can put inputs and outputs, sensors, all that stuff, relays to it, and you can control them, build your own apps for them, a lot of different stuff. And essentially, right here, this is just a temperature sensor. You can see it dropped out right here. This is during a small power failure with it when I was playing around with it earlier. But it works pretty well. You can see a peak here from like a shower, like for the humidity and stuff. It's quite interesting for tracking stuff like that. And actually, the reason why I have it in the bathroom is actually because I'm considering putting like a switch in the wall, that when the humidity rises in the bathroom, it will turn on the exhaust fan automatically, and that helps with like mold and whatever. So it's cool for managing stuff like that. And then I have some little LED strips that you can change the color of, just mounted underneath there. I'll show you a photo of the node in just a sec. We'll turn those off for now. You can see people, if they're home. I'm not going to click on that because that does have the location information along with a map over here. And then over here on temperature, I'm getting all these other nodes enabled, but this is like bathroom temperature, humidity, my room, living room. This will soon be the Nest thermostat I'm hoping to get in the near future. And this is my room, which the node is currently down, and I'll show you why. It's because I'm using that ESP8266 to demonstrate what it looks like. I actually have another ESP8266 out in the garage. Now, I can click on this here, and the garage won't do anything. It says, are you sure you want to open or close the garage door? Now, this is a really awesome feature. How I did that is through the UI and edit, and then under the YAML script, you can add in this, under the tap action, you can add in this confirmation thing and text for that. And it just makes it so that if you accidentally bump it on your phone, you don't end up opening or closing the garage. And that's really helpful. And then there's a little sensor thing up here that senses if it's closed or open. I'll show photos of all of this stuff. And I plan for this icon actually update with the garage door like this one does up here, but I haven't gotten to that yet. And then over here we have the network page, which is device statuses. I'm still getting this up. It's going to ping stuff like my PC, my EAS equipment, my two servers, stuff like that. And I did a whole network switch over to Ubiquiti recently, Ubiquiti equipment. So all my static IP addresses for all my local stuff, all my local static IPs are all out of whack. So I'm trying to get them all back to normal. And so all those say disconnected right now, but they are actually all connected and just fine. AdGuard control. I'm working on getting AdGuard set up. It's a DNS filter system. Essentially it looks for, like DNS servers that are like blacklisted or anything like that, gets rid of ads. It's pretty interesting. Evan's printer. I have a Canon TR450 series or 4500 series, and I was trying to get it to work before the live stream, but it would not show the ink levels or anything, and so I ended up having to delete it and then try to add it back in. So I have not added the entries back in. And this is first floor. So I'm working on this. This is going to be a floor plan, like, of the house. And I'm going to have all of the little objects around. And I mean, that will be kind of cool to have set up. So like bathroom lights and all that stuff. The temperature of each room will be all over the map. It'll be pretty cool. Logbook that logs stuff, when stuff happens, when I'm getting stuff figured out, you know, all that stuff, logins, whatever. ESP Home. ESP Home is... Garage should be online. There it goes. Okay. These are the ESP8266 boards. These little boards. And they are the boards that essentially allow you to network connect relays, LEDs, temperature sensors, whatever you want. So, and I can edit the code for each of those boards and update them remotely, like program them. So, and then there's terminal. So terminal, like, it's just a base terminal. It's a little add-on I got. It's instead of me having to SSH into the Raspberry Pi, which is essentially using a computer to get a remote command line to type stuff in to, you know, the command line on the Raspberry Pi. That's what SSH is. This just allows you to do it off the GUI. So that's kind of nice. Developer tools. Use this for getting information about different things. All these different things. Supervisor. We have AdGuard. All these different add-ons that I've added. There's the add-on store where you can add on cool different... to do different, like, different things with your home assistant server. Yeah, lots of little cool things here. You can add Spotify Connect. Chromie, I have this one set up. This is a NTP time server, so it syncs the time with the of the server to a time server, so they stay in time, which keeps everything running smooth. Snapshots of system, you know, there's information over there. Configuration, Home Assistant Cloud is the service by Home Assistant that allows you to control your Home Assistant with your Amazon Echo or Google Home. It also allows you to do remote access of this from around the world. Integrations. I'm not going to click on that, but that's essentially a list of all of your integrations. That has stuff like shows my email and stuff, which I don't want to give out. So it, just to show you, it gives a list of all of the different things, like the printer and the different ESP devices, all those things. Devices, again, it's a device list. Not much to see here. Gives you battery levels, too, of certain devices. Areas. These are areas of the house. Bathroom, garage, hallway, kitchen, outdoor, and the lab, aka the room here. And then I have scenes and automations. Automations, I have these two to turn off and on the lights and the little light strips in the bathroom. That automation, I'll also have an automation that will, like, you know, trigger maybe the lamppost out front, or it could turn on the fan when it gets to a certain humidity level. Stuff like that. And, you know, that's the easy way to create it. So if I was actually to create one right here, we could say, we'll create an automation. Let's say it's going to turn on my desk lamp in, I don't know, turn on desk lamp at, that's going to be what time? That's going to be 3:13. So 15, let's do at 15:14. Okay. Okay, we're gonna skip that. So I noticed that to be a little buggy, the little, like, create it automatically thing. So we're gonna do desk lamp. Okay. And we're going to just choose, you know, device, okay? And we're going to choose the desk lamp I have here, right there. And we're going to do trigger desk lamp on, and it's going to be hours. It's going to be 15 minutes. It's going to be, let's make it 15 and seconds, 0. And then, actually, wait, no, it has to be, excuse me with that. It actually has to be time, because this is the trigger. So it has to be at 15:15. And then the action will be a device, the desk lamp, and turn on the desk lamp, okay? And then we'll save that, okay? And there it is, okay? So at, you know, 15:15, so which is in like 2 minutes, it will turn on the desk lamp right here off to the side. So I'll let that run, and you'll see it a little bit here in the stream. Notifications, these are just if there's any errors in your configuration. And also, I highly recommend, if you're getting into this and you're using Home Assistant, the first thing you should ever get is this file editor right here. You need to get this. It's so helpful. I'll open the web interface, and it allows you to change everything in your configuration window. It allows you to change everything in your configuration YAML file, excuse me, and upload it or save it again to the Raspberry Pi, and then refresh the server or restart it. So this makes everything so much easier than having to take out the SD card. Oh, there it went. That's the light. So you saw the automation work. So essentially, it allows you to just put in all the devices, keep it all organized here. This is also how I add in all the pings for the different equipment, the doors, the garage door, different customizations. This is device tracker for APRS, which actually goes up under the map, but I'm not going to show that again. Shows locations. Raspberry Pi GPIO. You can use the GPIO pins on the Raspberry Pi to control relays. It's only binary, so therefore on or off. So it can sense stuff, and it can make things happen. So it can do a relay on off. It can sense if a door is open or closed. If it has two different variables, 1, 0, then it's binary. So that's the easy way to think of it. So like, yeah, I could turn off an LED with it. I could turn off my fan with it. Stuff like that. That's what I have. The green, yellow, red, and alarm is actually going to be hooked up to a stack light in the future to show statuses of the system. So like, if I get an alarm in the system, say temperature too high outside, whatever, starts flashing the red light, whatever, it will do something like that. I'm still working on it. So that's Home Assistant. It's pretty fun. And then we'll go back to OBS here and go back to my camera. So I'm actually gonna go take 1 minute real quick, and I'm gonna go grab something, so I will be right back, and just hold on, it will literally be 1 minute. Okay, sorry about that. Just had to grab that. Okay, I was gonna go grab this. This is a little breadboard with an ESP8266 on it. And this is what I use for prototyping. It's the Evans Lab one in ESP Home. I have three of these, one's for the garage door, one's for the bathroom, and one is this test one I have. And this is what they look like. Just thought I would show you. Just a little board. They have a whole bunch of pins on the outside. I can take it out of the breadboard. And those pins act like GPIO pins on a Raspberry Pi. Has one analog input, though you can use different types of chips to shift that analog, an analog input into a digital, so you can get more analog inputs if you need it. Pretty sure there's a script for that also on ESP Home's website. And I just have a breadboard here to pin it out, to test things like LEDs and get in different things I've been trying to do hooked up to it. So it's really nice to just set on your desk, start working with. So, yeah, and if you're wondering where you can get these, you can get a 3-pack on Amazon for, I think, $13, which is really cheap. If you compare, like, you imagine you could make, like, let's say here, probably at least, you know, 7 smart switches out of this, probably even more. I don't know the exact number, but let's say you can make 10 smart switches out of this. I know you can definitely make 7, but say you could do that. You imagine Wemo switches, which are the switches I have right here that I'm using for the desk lamps and all that stuff. These things right here, these three. Those are like $40 each. And imagine if you can do that for way cheaper with an ESP8266. It just makes sense to go this route. Get a relay board, an 8-channel relay board. Get a gang plug. Like, you could easily do this. You can just take the Raspberry Pi that you're running the Home Assistant server on, and get a 4-channel relay board, and get a 4-gang breakout box for plugs, outlets. So it has 4 outlets on it, and you can individually control each of those outlets. So that allows you to essentially a way cheaper switch. You got 4 outputs for way cheaper. And imagine if you can build like maybe 3 of those, put them all there, and then have it all running off the Raspberry Pi, you know, GPIO pins, get an 8-channel one. Imagine what you could do. It's way cheaper. That's why I prefer to go with homemade equipment than buying the off-the-shelf stuff. I'll only buy the off-the-shelf stuff if I really need to, can't figure it out. Like, for instance, I don't want to screw up the HVAC system. So, I'm considering buying a Nest thermostat. I'm also getting a Ring doorbell here real soon to actually hook up to this. I'm getting really into this hobby. It's quite interesting. There'll definitely be more future videos on it. That's all I could say. But, yeah. So, ESP8266, Raspberry Pis, those are the way to go. And for anybody who's wondering, the Raspberry Pi server's literally right here. It's just this little black box. Didn't even know it was there. It's just out of the way. Stick it next to your Wi-Fi router. Does the job just fine. Now, I would like to show, if I can, gotta make sure there's nothing on here. Yep. Okay, that'll be fine. So, this is actually, the Ubiquiti Wi-Fi, thing. I've been working on getting this all set up. I just switched all my network stuff, parents helped invest in it a bit, but they invested in the equipment. I've been helping with the setup, and I have helped set up the Unify network, and it is really nice. I will have to do a video just about Unify and Ubiquiti, because I have really liked how they have all their stuff set up here. You can just see the UI here. It's really, really nice. And I could probably pop over to the clients list real quick, too. That'll probably be fine, yeah. And it just gives me, like, a list of all the devices that are connected. You can see the Wemos right there, the Wemo switches and the ESP 8266 boards there, too. So, that's pretty fun. And that's, that's the network. It's a, if you're interested, it's a Ubiquiti Dreamcast. It's really interesting Wi-Fi router. It's like a little pill. Also, in the future, I told you about this rack. It's going to be getting updated. I'm going to be getting a full-size rack, actually. Go from the floor all the way up to the ceiling. And in that, I hope to put a network switch and a patch panel for all the equipment that's in this room. Because I have a nice little 6-port switch on my desk right here. And that does not get the job done because, like, I have a lot of other stuff in here that can run off Wi-Fi or Ethernet, and I just want to run everything off Ethernet. It's faster, it's easier to manage, and if you get Ubiquiti, you can manage each port on the switch, throttle it, whatever you need. It's really cool. So, hopefully you'll see something when I do that. I'm actually going to be doing an underground installation under the crawl space. A Cat 8 cable from the living room into here and then right into the wall over there to connect it to the rack. And if you don't know, Cat 8 is like a really good like shielded Ethernet cable that you can... it's actually relatively cheap too. It's actually if you're doing short runs, that if you're gonna buy a whole spool of it, it's a little more expensive. So yeah, everything will be Cat 8 coming from there, and then splitting up into the room to all the different things I need will be Cat 6A. And that's a shielded type of cable also. I'm going everything shielded. And the reason why is because I have RF equipment in here. Radios, repeaters, all that stuff. And if you don't get shielded, the radio waves could go into the you know, Ethernet cable like it's an antenna. Especially through long runs, like from the living room to here. And that could produce problems. RF down the line, you know, who knows what. And it can cause problems. So, highly recommend going with shielded Ethernet cable if you're an amateur radio operator or doing some install for up at like a radio site or anything that uses radios heavily or any type of RF transmissions besides Wi-Fi. Because Wi-Fi is usually really low power and usually don't have to worry about it. Wow, we got 8 viewers right now. So, let me make sure I'm making through all my list here. I was gonna say, the 4 little, or 5 actually, little automations I'm working on that, I'm gonna be using home automation for is, I wanna know when the garage door is open at night, give it, ping to the phone or whatever, you know, notification. Also, if the temperature gets too low out there because the garage door's left open, you know, all that stuff. Just, you know, peace of mind. Also, running lamppost and outdoor lights for, you know, and indoor lights for when, you know, we're not home. You know, everybody uses timers and all that stuff. You know, you can do that, but the... You know, then you have to unplug them when you're all not there, when you're there, and then put them all back on when you're not. And I think it's way more cleaner and nice. It's really fun. Temperature automation, you know, knowing, you know, keeping, you know, more of a eco-friendly temperature on the house using Nest in the future. Bathroom fan automation, keeping, you know, humidity down in the bathroom. That's why we have fans. all bathrooms that have a shower has a fan to keep the humidity going out or smell or whatever. And that's, you know, humidity causes mold, and that's why you could do something for automating that. And home slash away automation. Like I said, with the lighting, you could do a home lighting selection and a away lighting selection, and also run, you know, security stuff. So like Amazon Echo released a thing where you can know if there's a fire alarm going off or a glass break or stuff like that. But it needs to be put into that mode when you're not home. So what if it could do it automatically based on the GPS position of your device? And since I'm in a family with four people who have four devices, if all those devices leave, or if three of them leave, then, you know, and they leave within a certain perimeter, then maybe it will go to away mode, bring down the temperature of the house to the proper level, all that stuff. Just keeping more eco-friendly with power. It's a really nice thing to use. Okay, so I think I covered everything I wanted to on the home automation stuff, actually. So that's pretty good. Making good time on that, too. So actually, in the near future here, I'm actually going to have a Minecraft server running here. I know this is kind of funny. Probably not a lot of people care on the YouTube, because that's not what I do. I don't do gaming. I play, like, Minecraft, and that's it. So, I'm just saying, putting a Minecraft server out there, if anybody plays Minecraft, feel free to join. I'm going to have the link up in probably next week's live stream or something. I'll release it. I have the link already. I'm just still testing it and making sure that the server can handle multiple people. Talked about the Ethernet cable and all that. And then also someone asked last time what I was talking about with the audio stream. That is an Icecast audio stream. And what that is it's just like, if you've ever gone on to one of those live streams where you just click on a link and then you get one of those, like, just pause and play buttons and a volume slider and the rest of the screen's all black. Usually that's an MP3 Icecast stream. And that is what that PC down there runs for the EAS stuff. I'm just throwing that out there. I also am running another stream. I'm actually running two streams. There's a little scanner up there with a weather radio, or scanner slash weather radio, whatever. It receives radio frequencies in FM. And so the... Here, hold on. Okay, got a message. Someone asked, actually, what is the lowest rack mount device in my rack? I'll have to fix the light in here. But that is an Arcom repeater controller. And then there's a shelf right above it. That's an Arcom repeater controller. It's actually going to be hooked up to the EasyCast real soon. And that's for when I transmit the NOAA weather alerts over the repeater system. That's to help manage it. It's also going to maybe run an auto patch in the future. If you don't know what an auto patch is, I don't blame you. It's kind of an older thing. It's not used much anymore. But essentially, an auto patch is a wired phone line coming into the repeater controller, and that allows you to use a radio handheld, this one right here, and talk from this radio to that radio, and then into the phone system. Also, dial using DTMF, and essentially call people. Which can help if you're in an area without any cell coverage. If you're in no cell coverage, need 911 assistance, auto patch can help with that. So yeah, so the Arcom repeater controller will actually be running the PTT of the radio and the ID, actually, the identification message for the EAS equipment that's transmitting. It'll also send out some DTMF codes in order to link and unlink the repeaters. See if I have any questions here. Okay. So yeah, that's what I got for all that equipment. Just to follow up with last week's live stream. I did also add in a button right here. It just kind of hangs off. I'm actually going to turn this one shelf. I'm going to put a voltmeter and ammeter in it. You can see the hole where a voltmeter used to be. It used to be in microvolts, so I didn't need it. But I'm going to put it for volts, and it will tell me if the 12-volt line. And maybe I'll put in a 120-volt meter in there, whatever. And then I'll have some LED indicators, and I'll be mounting this button. And this essentially just turns off and on the internal speaker on the end deck. It has some ports on the back terminals to allow that to happen. So, that's what that does. The top shelf actually has the 12-volt power supplies in it. I also got that question. Has the 12-volt power supplies and the transmitter in it? So, yeah. Like I said, the little radio over right underneath the Midland weather radio is actually transmitting a stream now. It's on NOAAweatherradio.org. You can check them out. They are creating a list of all the NOAA weather channels across the United States. Say you don't have a weather radio, but you have a phone. You know, most people have smartphones these days. You could go on to their website, find your local area, and listen to the feed. I learned that Portland, Oregon, over where I'm at, didn't have a feed. And I was like, man, I have all the equipment right here to do that. So I started up an Icecast stream, sent them an email, and they added it the next day. So that is available for you to listen into. It's KIG98 is the stream. You can find it on their website. Should show my call sign and my name also as credit. And there's a scanner right next to it. I use that as an extra input to the EasyCast sometimes. Oh, also, I got a question about the screen. People asked what I use for that clock up there. It's a screensaver. If you search up digital clock screensaver, you will find that exact screensaver is one of the top ones, and it's freeware. It does show like an advertisement to their website like every 3 hours or something in the top corner. Barely noticeable. I did not notice it for days before when I had it. It just caught me off guard one time. Yeah, highly recommend it. It's really easy to install. Works with Windows 10 and Windows 7. It's nice to have up there as a clock. Plus, all my computers and servers are all, or that one server I have, and my computers are all synced to rather GPS or NTP time servers. I have a GPS receiver in the window right outside here, plugged in to this computer here, which runs a NTP time server for the rest of the house. And essentially all the devices can connect to the IP address of this device, my desktop PC here, and update their time. And it's accurate enough. It's not like down to like the picosecond, okay? But it's accurate enough to keep everything within, you know, 1 second or so. I've never had it like drift off beyond like a half a second. It's really accurate though, and when you're running stuff like home automation, this here, and a server there, you kind of want everything to all be on the same time. So there's a little software package I use for that called I forgot what it was called. I want to find it for you because it's a nice piece of software. And I really like it. And it's not supported for their... they don't have support on it anymore. So they actually made it free to download now. The rest of their programs, their newer version of it, you have to pay for. But it's actually new. This one is free now, so you can use it. It's called NMETA Time. NMETA Time. It's NMEA time. No, for, yeah, so NMEA time. Nice program. I can make a whole video just about that. So. So yeah, all the devices here are synced over GPS and NTP. Just wanted to point that out along with that screensaver. And, yeah. So. Let's see if I have anything else I want to cover here real fast. Oh yeah, I should probably cover what we're going to be covering next live stream. I was thinking about doing some stuff with APRS. I actually have off to the side here. I'm not going to show it because I want to save it for next live stream. But I have a laptop that runs a desktop version of Raspbian and a radio that uses Vox, which is essentially when you feed audio into it, it senses the audio and it starts transmitting. So there's no PTT line or any serial interface or nothing like that. It's just the microphone and headphone input on the laptop. Really nice. And I want to do a whole live stream just about that. I've used that setup for over a year and a half now. That one laptop, no joke, it has the uptime on it. It's freaking crazy. But that just transmits APRS for locally here, and it allows me to receive messages. I message through the APRS system every so often, especially when Josh, KI6NAZ, from Ham Radio Crash Course, when he's on his live streams, I'll send him a message via APRS, and it's nice to have that ready. So, yeah, I highly recommend checking his videos out. If you're getting into ham radio, go check out Josh, KI6NAZ, Ham Radio Crash Course on YouTube. If you go to my YouTube channel and you look in the right-hand sidebar, you'll actually find his YouTube channel. Yes, using the Raspberry Pi version of Debian on a full PC. It's an HP, it was running Windows XP, but it's a little HP laptop. And yeah, Debian, had a desktop release of Jesse. Now they use Buster. But back on Jesse, they had a desktop version. They probably have a Buster desktop version. I just haven't checked. I'm sure they do. But yeah, it just runs that. Oh yeah. Updated this. I have a strobe light up there. So someone asked about that and what I did to hook it up. Just a relay. The relay built into the NDEC or the trilithic works just fine whenever it transmits or receives. I use the beacon up there for the trilithic because the trilithic has the radios in it and it receives all the local alerts here. So I really want the flashing thing that's going to wake me up in the middle of the night to only be if it's actually pertinent to what I'm doing, like my area, I mean. And then there's a little light right here. I had to put a little piece of like cloth over it to keep it was a little bright, but it's just an orange light that stays on. I have a few of these things, just little amber lights that are meant for like vehicles, little like marker lights. They were actually used as strobe lights for putting like on your bumper bar for like public service vehicles. They're amber. So, yeah, just have that hooked up to the 12-volt power supply I use for the beacon, and that one just stays solid. It doesn't flash, so it's less likely to get my attention, and that's for my NDEC, which receives NERP alerts for Illinois and New York, which I have some followers, like Zayzone TV, who's in the chat. Hey. He's out in New York, and he receives alerts that are out there, and I receive them here from his live stream, and he receives my alerts from my live stream. So yeah, it's pretty cool. Also makes the station way more active. I don't get a lot of alerts out here, but like in the off time, it's nice to hear other stuff. Well, not nice to hear. We never want to hear alerts, but it makes it more active. And for the people who are interested in the hobby, yeah. Okay. Just looking at my thing here. Making sure everything is working on the stream. Okay. So yeah, I think I've covered everything I was wishing to think. Wishing to cover. So I thought about making a small box that overlays emergency alert info on screen when one is received. Talking about character generator. Actually, just learned. Character generator that's built into the Trilithic EasyCast, is actually, hold on one sec. The Trilithic EasyCast has a built-in character generator, and that actually you can output directly to RCA. You know how they have the left-right video, and they have the left-right audio, and then they have the yellow video connector. The yellow video connector is the same formatting as SDA, which is the BNC connection. Used for video. Had no clue. So used a direct adapter an adaption, not even a converter, just a cable from BNC in the character generator on the EasyCast into the RCA video connector on my TV/computer monitor. And it worked. So that's kind of cool. Hopefully in the future when I get this full size rack, I might be taking down the pegboard and putting two monitors right there. I was hoping. I don't know if I'll get those monitors, but one of them will hopefully run the character generator. So yeah, I think I've covered everything in the stream that I wanted to cover. So tune in next week for more stuff about radio. Appreciate everybody who came out to watch the stream, listen to it, whatever you're doing in the background. I know there's people working on projects and stuff. Pretty crazy with the whole virus stuff going around. So just to take my mind off that, and hopefully take your mind off that, just doing these live streams. So with that, appreciate everybody who came here, and I'll see y'all next time. Live streams every Sunday at 3:00 Pacific time. So until then, see ya.